Welcome. Good morning and welcome to First Presbyterian Church, Newcastle. It is so good to be here on this beautiful Sunday morning, first Sunday in April. Our gathering hymn this morning, Open My Eyes That I May See, is in our celebration hymnal number 563. And we did just do that. It is indeed a blessing to be here. We'll do the mission moment for mission, one great hour of sharing. First of all, I want to thank First Presby for all the giving and support that you do for our mission committee here and for the PCUSA, the support that you give. You've been giving to your Ukraine issue, and we really thank you for that. We appreciate your giving. One great hour of sharing is 70 years old in the PCUSA. It has, under that umbrella, there's three areas. One is the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, the Presbyterian Hunger Program, and the Presbyterian Self-Development of People. All three of those are under that umbrella. And thanks to Carolyn Mooney, who usually does this and wasn't able to do it. So she gave me a presentation to give to you. God bless her for her dedication to missions. When Jesus walked this earth, he was always to be found where someone was in need of healing, nourishment, salvation. Where might we imagine he would be found in today's world? Perhaps he would be overseeing the planting of papaya and tangerine trees in Madagascar, school gardens in Palestine, or greenhouses in Haitian communities. Perhaps Jesus would be at work in Detroit, Michigan, where warriors on wheels deliver groceries, do light housekeeping, and offer personal care to low-income project members, or in Hopkins Village, Belize, helping women develop economic skills to financially support their families. Or perhaps he would be guiding COVID-19 response around the globe, or leading a refuge of Venezuela's social political chaos to life-saving cancer surgery in the U.S. In fact, the PCUSA, a part of the body of Christ on earth today, has seen these miracles transform lives through the work of the Presbyterian Hunger Programs, taking action that all might be fed, self-development of people's partnering with communities experiencing poverty or oppression, and Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, working amid the devastation of natural or human-caused disasters. Our participation in 2022, One Great Hour of Sharing, connects us to God's work, and through congregations in every corner of the church and with partners all over the world. Learn more about these outreaches through your bulletin inserts and look for your offering envelopes on Palm Sunday, April the 10th, as we share in a large way that Presbyterians come together to work for a better world. Christ is here with us. And when we all do a little, it adds up to a lot. Let us pray, heal us, O Savior, that we might understand and grow our relationships with all those in need. Thank you for connecting us with one another and with you. Amen. And thank you, Carolyn. Let's welcome Vinny Wise, who's going to bless us with his gift this morning.
Good morning. I would solicit your prayers. I'm on this journey to be a part of the TV show The Voice. And I had my first audition in December, and I have a second one coming up in June. So I'm a little nervous, but with God, we can do all things.
Let your sweet aroma fill my life. Rose of Sharon, show me how to grow in beauty in God's sight. Of 10,000, make me a reflection of your light. Oh, and day star shine down on me, and let your love shine through me in the night. Anywhere you open up that door, and let your word speak to me, show me what I've never seen before. Lord, I wanna be your witness, 'cause you can take what's wrong and make it right. And day star shine down on me, and let your love shine through me in the night. Lord, I see a world that's dying, wounded by the master of deceit. He's groping in the darkness, hounded by the years of past defeat. But then I see you standing near me, Lord, shining with compassion in your eyes. Oh, Jesus, shine down on me, and let your love shine through me in the night. Oh, lead me, Lord, I'll follow. Anywhere you open up that door. Cause you can take what's wrong and make it right. Day star, shine down on me and let your love shine through me in the night. Jesus, shine down on me and let your love shine through me in the night. Day star, shine on me, let your love shine through me in the night.
Thank you, Vinny, and may the Lord bless you in your journey. Thank you. Pray with me this morning. Eternal God, your kingdom has broken into our troubled world through the life, the death, and the resurrection of your Son. Help us to hear your word and obey it, that we may become instruments of your saving love. Of course, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, our God, now and forever. Guide us, O God. We welcome you into this place this morning. You have a perfect plan for this day. Ask that you would have your way. Bless the hearts that have gathered together this morning for your purpose, your plan. We invite you, Holy Spirit. In Christ I pray. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning, Here I Am, Lord. Let's together read our prayer of humility, written in today's bulletin. Lord, we know we can be burdened by changes. We can become afraid when the chapters of our lives turn. Our doubts tell us to stay in bed and avoid the unknown as another day ends. We mourn what is changing, seeing it is a loss. Lord, remind us that it only takes a moment in your light to make all our fears fall away. In your light, we find peace. In your grace, we find voices of doubt lose their power. And we can look forward in your love. We can find the strength to put aside all fears and see your glory in life's movements. In the light of the Holy Spirit, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, we are granted salvation, salvation that brings the dawn of the risen sun when the night ends. Please take a few moments for your own personal confession. Every priest goes to work at the altar each day, offers the same old sacrifice year in and year out, and never makes a dent in the sin problem. As a priest, Christ made a single sacrifice for sins, and that was it. Then he sat down right beside God and waited for his enemies to cave in. It was a perfect sacrifice by a perfect person to perfect some very imperfect people. By that single offering, he did everything that needed to be done for everyone who takes part in the purifying process. Please join in reading together. Through the waters of baptism, we have died, Christ, and are raised with him. With gratitude and with faith, we will walk the way of Christ. And this is the good news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We welcome Vinnie Wise again with a musical selection. And this morning, our special speaker is our wonderful, praise God, pastor. Just a moment here. I want to get it out there. So glad to see you. Yes. I know God has prepared a word through you. So just relax, breathe in, breathe out. We're ready to eat spiritually after this song. Pastor, you're welcome to come.
Amen. I'd like for everyone to just, this song is entitled Feel the Nails. Just personalize it in your own personal life. And you don't have to say anything, but God looks at the heart, and he hears the heart. So each day that we live, we ask the question, Lord, do you still feel the nails every time we fail? Tell me Jesus died for my transgressions, and that he paid that price a long, long time ago, when he gave his life for me on a hill called Calvary. But there's something else I want. I want to know, does he still feel the nails every time I fail? Can he hear the crowd cry, crucify again? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. It seems that I'm so good at breaking my promises, and that I treat your precious grace so carelessly. But you know what? Each time he forgives, what if he relives the agony he felt on that tree? Am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change. I just can't bear the thought of hurting him. Oh, am I causing him pain? Then I know I've got to change. Lord, I never want to hurt again. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, crucified you, Jesus, with my sins. Whoa, I'm so tired of playing these games. Lord, I really want to change. I never want to hurt, never want to hurt you again. Oh,
going to start with an apology. I don't know why I wrote down service was at 11. I even made a wrong turn, and when it went from I was getting here at 10 after 10 to 18 after 10, I was like, it's fine. This is like four different nightmares of mine all coming together. But I'm so happy I was able to get here in time, and I'm so grateful that you have leadership here that is able to pick up when the pastor drops the ball. So thank you very much. Let us all pray. Awesome and gracious Lord, we ask that you would open our minds, open our ears, and open our hearts. Open us to the word that you would have us receive this day. Open us to what it is we need to hear, what it is we need to know, and what it is we need to feel. We ask that the distance between lips and ears would be holy ground for your spirit to dance, so that we may grow more and more into the people you have called us to be. We open ourselves to your word, and we are so grateful. Amen. From Isaiah chapter 43, 16 to 21. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they might declare my praise. And then the letter of Paul to the Philippians, chapter 3, the second half of verse 4 through 14. Even though I too have reason for confidence in the flesh, if anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews. As to the law, a Pharisee. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. So if you recall the last time I was here, I talked a lot about chess. And so in order to maintain this appearance of intellectuality, I'm going to talk a little bit about philosophy. Ha ha. Specifically, I want to talk about time. Do you know what time is? Time is actually a meaningless thing. Think about it. What is a foot? What is an inch? What is a pound? These words of measurement have no meaning unless you talk about what it is about. What is a foot? I don't know, but I'm six of them. What is a pound? I don't know, outside of when I buy salami. What is time? It's a measurement to help us understand change. So we sometimes like to think that time is eternal, time is never ending, time is, but it's not time, it's change. We needed a way to measure the seasons, so we created a measurement. We needed a way to understand as the sun goes up and down, so we created a way to measure it. We attach these measurements to things that make sense to us, but inevitably, time is just how we understand the unstoppable change that comes about. There is no stopping change, and that is terrifying sometimes. I think about Paul sitting in a jail cell writing this letter to the Philippians. And I think it's interesting that he draws these two parallels between who he was and who he is. He talks about how blameless he is, his status, his privilege. The first four things he talks about are things that he had nothing to do with. He was born into them. He didn't have a choice to be circumcised on the eighth day. He just was. He didn't have a choice as to who he was born to. He just was. He didn't have a choice in the tribe or the place. And yet all of these things he was given. He had status. And the other three things he talks about are how he maintained that, how he maintained this righteousness that he was born with. As to the law, he was a Pharisee. He followed the law. He did what it said. Paul is acutely aware of what the law says, and acutely aware of how best to follow it. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church, Paul was so devoted to the church that he was a persecutor. He went after anyone and everyone who would detract from it. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. And Paul is talking about these things, and we might think, oh, isn't he talking about all his accomplishments? And then when he turns around and says, none of those things matter. They're all rubbish. We might start to think about what it was that he was doing in those things. He was born into this certain place, and he worked very hard to maintain that. He worked very hard to avoid change of that status. If you think about change, does it scare you? I believe it scared Paul before he encountered Christ. The idea that he could become blamed under the law, I believe, was a scary prospect. The idea that he could no longer be among the elite, among Israel, was scary. The idea that who he had always been could change. And so he worked very hard to not have that happen. And all of this work has culminated, and now he's sitting in a jail cell awaiting the end of his mortality. When Paul talks about that he is looking forward, he is driving forward instead of looking behind, I believe that he is talking about a difference between who he was and who he is. And it is how he deals with change. Who he was someone who wanted to maintain and not change. And none of that matters anymore, because the only thing that Paul cares about now is Christ. The only thing that is pushing him forward is Christ. The only thing that is worth it is Christ. And when he says these other things are garbage, it's not because those things don't matter. It's because what he has received is so much greater. I've been here the whole time. Didn't do it. Whatever it was, wasn't me. I'm a younger child. That is my initial reaction whenever there's something bad happening. Didn't do it, wasn't me. Even if it was. Where was I before my brain tangented? Talking about Paul, right? I think about who I was before I became a father. I love my kids. They are the greatest thing that has ever happened to me. That doesn't mean when I say that, that I don't actually think very highly of my wedding day, right? It's just, this has such value that by comparison, everything else falls away somewhat. This is what Paul is talking about. He had status. He had privilege. He was who he was supposed to be. And he maintained that zealously. He was blameless under the law. I don't know if you've read the Old Testament. There's a lot of laws. That's hard to do. And Paul is not saying this to dust off his shoulders. I was blameless. He's saying it because there are people around who will lift up how they've maintained their status and say, this is what makes me better. We can all think of someone who might try to prop up who they are based on who they've been and not think so much about where they're going. And so I ask you, what is it that you value? What is the importance in your life? What is the importance in the life of this church? What is the importance? Where do you place value? Is it in what has always been, or is it in pursuing something else? Is it in looking behind, or is it in looking ahead? Now, it's very easy to stand up here and say, we should all be looking forward through Christ. I know that who we are today is built on who we have been. It is undeniable that there is a past, there are traditions, there are things of import. But the question is not, are these things important? The question is, why? When Paul is looking back on his history, why was it important that he follow the law so closely? And I think the fact that he says he was blameless It was his own righteousness. It's not that those things weren't important. It's that he was doing them for himself. He was doing them to maintain who he was, to avoid the change of the world around him. And now he's running on the winds of change. The world is different for Paul, and he cannot hold back the tide. He dances across the winds of change. And I wonder if this passage from Isaiah that Paul would have known suddenly takes on a new meaning. I am about to do a new thing. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The God of creation had to have known what change was and how unstoppable it would be and how difficult it would be for us that we would set a measuring stick against it to try to understand it better. But what is important? What do you value? Think on these things. Think about what is pushing you forward. Think about the path you are on. Think about what you are straining for as opposed to what you are leaving behind. Because every morning when you open your eyes, you are a new person with new opportunities to make the world a better place. Do you seize that, or do we try to make the world how it once was and battle against the one thing we will never be able to defeat? Change. Paul is telling us that Christ is so good that faith in Jesus is so worth it. That leaving behind the things of the past, it's not abandoning things, it's shaking off shackles. It is leaving behind all that would slow you down. Christ is so good, our eyes cannot help but be strained forward to where we can run to. And yet, we have gathered here also to celebrate communion, a tradition of the church, something where we look behind. Isn't that antithetical to everything I've been saying? And yet, what does a runner need, if not fuel? You know, it's fascinating thinking about how we were built as people. Did you know that you were created a better distance runner than a horse? It's true. When scientists have looked back at how people were evolved and created, they see that we were built for endurance hunting. At some point in time, you were capable of chasing down a deer. Not in the short course, but the long one. You were built for the long race. And what is it that you need to run it? You need sustenance. Communion is not simply a remembering of what was. It is sustaining us for the work that we are still pursuing. It is fueling our bodies and souls as a reminder that our feet still have journeys to tread, that our eyes moving forward still have feet that have to carry us there, and God will sustain us. That as we run on the winds of change, we do so not solely off of our own strength, but we do so through the power and grace of Jesus Christ, who knows that we need fuel for our bodies to do the work of the kingdom. Brothers and sisters, think of what is important to you. Think of how Christ is shifting your eyes forward down the path ahead. And know that you are sustained not only on the word of God, but on the very bread that is the body of Christ, on the very blood of the sacrifice. You are sustained not only in spirit, but in body as well. Let us pray. Awesome and gracious Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for gathering us together from all the different places we have been. We thank you and we praise your holy name for the opportunity to gather together. We ask that you would keep our eyes forward, that you would remind us that even when we celebrate traditions in the church, it is not because we are looking behind us, it is because these are the things that push us forward. That the purpose of tradition and sacraments is not solely to look back, but to give us the strength and energy to move forward. And God, when we are scared, when the world feels like it is so full of change that we cannot possibly change with it, remind us of Paul sitting in that jail cell. Remind us of all that he had worked to maintain and then cast aside. Remind us that we do not do these things alone, but we are carried along in the power of the Spirit. And when we are scared and weak, you come alongside to sustain us. And that we not only are created to run this long race, but you have built us to endure, to change as the winds, to recognize the new creation that you are making, and to value where it is we are going. We thank you and praise your holy name for this gift. Amen. Our hymn of grace is "Though I May Speak." If you would all stand and sing with me. Remembering what I said about traditions, you may be seated. Remember what I said about traditions and about how when we do these things in church, it is not about simply looking back, but being pushed forward. We stand on the shoulders of giants that have come before, recognizing what was important is not about looking behind us, but being pushed from behind. Let us together affirm the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Now, I believe this is the first time I'm doing communion here. And boy, would it have been nice to get here early to talk about how y'all do communion. Because here's a little note from a Pulpit Supply pastor. There are things that churches do differently. We are all Presbyterian, we are all Shenango Presbytery, and yet we are all individual churches as well. And so there are things that you do that other churches do not. There are things that other churches do that you do not. And this is not because we are so very different, but it is because we are one family. What a beautiful reminder that we all sit at one table, and yet I don't need to be you, and you do not need to be me in order to share in this meal. That simply because you may do things differently than Sandy Lake Presbyterian Church does not mean that you are wrong. It just means that you are you, and they are them, and we are united, not by what we do the same, but through Christ. All that to say, we have gathered for communion. One table around which one family, not limited by the walls of this church, but a family that extends beyond, bound together by Jesus Christ. This is the Lord's table, and we partake in it. If you would pray together with me. Awesome and gracious Lord, we thank you and praise your holy name for this. We thank you for this meal. We ask that it would be a blessing to our bodies, that it would carry us and sustain us through the work you have put before us. We are so grateful for the reminder of who we are and for the push to continue moving into who we are called to be. Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to our Lord and God. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise. Now, who wants to be the person to say, hey, this is how we do it? Yeah.
Just go down front and do your thing.
As you hold.
only what you have, but of who you are. Let us all pray. Awesome and gracious Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to give. We thank you for the variety of ways that we are able to do this. We lift up to you what we have. More than that, we lift up to you who we are. Who we are as beloved children of God, and it is in this identity that we have gathered here this day to pray. We pray for a world that is hurting. We pray for people in pain. We pray for those who need to know your guidance and see your will. We pray for Anna, for Bill and Esther. We pray for Mariska, for Gina, for Darlene, for Randy, for Bob, for Kim, for Marcia, for Chad, for Tom, Carolyn and Betty, Barbara and Natalie. We remember those who may not be able to do all that they once did. We lift up in our hearts Mike and Nancy, Jim and Tom and Bob, Lois, Bill and Joan, Connie and Dorothy. We lift up to you all of those who are struggling in one way or another, knowing that you know who they are and you know how best to care for them, and yet we still lift our words up knowing that you hear us and you care about what we pray for. That you listen to the whispers of our hearts, not as the King of Kings far removed, but as the good Father listens to the whispers of their children. We give to you things and people that weigh on us, knowing that you share the burden. And we give to you the things and the people that give us joy because you rejoice with us. That there is no burden so great or joy so small that you will not take it on with us. And so, Lord, we pray for things that seem so much bigger than us. We pray for the conflict in Ukraine. We pray for refugees, not only in Ukraine, but refugees who struggle and strive and seek safety all over. We pray for those who have stayed to fight back. And Lord, we ask for wisdom and grace, knowing that bloodshed is not what you desire. We ask that hearts would be softened, eyes would be opened, and your guidance would be felt. And Lord, we celebrate this church. We celebrate ministries that are happening. We celebrate leadership who will take on responsibilities at a moment's notice. We thank you for keeping this church moving forward, pursuing instead of looking behind. As they continue to do the work that you have set before them, we are reminded that this work that we do not do it as simply laborers in your vineyard. We do not do it simply as peasants before the king, but we are your children. That is what you created us to be. That is what you have called us into. And so it is remembering not only who you are that we have gathered together this day, but it is remembering who we are, living more and more into our identity as beloved children of God, as brothers and sisters in Christ that we have gathered. And it is in this identity that we lift our voices up together, using the words given to us by Jesus Christ. Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now I'm assuming, because no one threw something at me, that I did okay. All right. By the way, again, I have three small children. If you need to stop me throwing something, always welcome. Brothers and sisters, as we prepare ourselves to take what we have heard and what we have learned here this day and carry it with us into the world around us, let us sing our closing hymn, This Is My Song. Brothers and sisters, receive the benediction this day. In our brightest of days and in our blackest of nights, we are never outside of God's sight. Let we who worship Jesus Christ go forth, always moving towards his divine light. Let us go knowing that we have been created specifically for a purpose by God the Father. Let us go knowing that we have reason to dance on the winds of change because of the grace of Jesus Christ the Son. And let us go knowing that our eyes are trained forward and we are carried through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.